Hey, everyone. We are about to start one of our most highly anticipated and third in our first ever series that we're calling Man at Cannes. So please come over and take a seat because I'm telling you, it gets packed very, very fast. My name is Carolyn Detman, and I am the CMO here at the Female Quotient. And we felt like this year is the right time to be actually bringing the mantle back, except this time the mantle is actually diverse, and they're talking about topics that we never hear executive men talk about on the way to make progress in gender equality. So as an example, on Monday we had chief executive officers talking about, are they willing to share the care at home? Yesterday we had C-suite men talking about being allies but authentic. And today we're talking about something that just hits me very dearly. How many times have us women been in a meeting where a chief executive or executive male says that he really started to care about gender equality when he had a daughter? Raise hands. Anybody? Yes. So that used to irk me, because I always felt like, well, don't you have a mother? That always used to irk me. But it really, I thought, was true. So regardless, to kind of inform us, and Ipsos, where's Nicholas? There you are. Ipsos is such a great partner that they did research for us because we wanted to research what topics we should be doing and what men do care about. And I'm going to show you the video in a second, but this really, I mean, this goes against what I said. So I was wrong, and I just, when I'm wrong, I say it. Men agree that having a son, 75% of men agreed that having a son at 75% or daughter, 77%. I mean, it's pretty much neck and neck, made them pay more attention to gender equality. So it does appear that parenthood in general is what makes them care the most, but we also found that men with no children overwhelmingly do care about gender equality. So the time is to have the conversation. So I'm gonna stop talking. I'm gonna turn it over to Jameson Fleming from Adweek, who's gonna moderate this fantastic panel. And I wanna thank the men for showing up and being like upping their style game this year, I will say. And really quick, just a quick video that gives you a little bit of sense of the research.
We are creating a conversation in a safe space publicly to model conversations that I believed were so important for men to witness. And that's where the growth happens. Here's me being vulnerable. I'm seeing it as a strength.
So I am Jameson Fleming, managing editor at Adweek, and we're going to kick this off. We're going to go down the row. I'll have them introduce themselves, and I'm going to have each one of you say, what's one skill or change to your leadership style that you picked up after you had kids? And then I'll just start with, I struggled sometimes when I need to communicate something to somebody and they're not understanding it. And I think having a kid taught me when they go through their why stage, you quickly learn a thousand different ways to communicate a point to somebody. And so I think for me, that was a big change that I underwent when I became a dad. So we'll go down the row.
You want to start with me?
Well, yeah, right next to me.
Answer. My name's Zach Chapman. I'm SVP of Global Partnerships at NBCU. And I'm a proud dad of three. My oldest is 18, and she's about to go off to college, which is an emotional time for me. My son is 17, and I've got my youngest, who's 14. She's my baby. Anyway, I would say the biggest thing that I changed after child number one was almost exactly what you said. It's this increase in patience, right? And I think that the way that it affected my management style and what I was doing at work was not only the explaining stuff, but just taking a breath and realizing that not everybody's in the same headspace you are all the time. And so giving somebody a chance, even though at that time, obviously my child couldn't speak to me, but trying to wait for them to come, you know, with either some solutions of their own or whatever, but just that patience piece.
Hi, I'm Jonathan Mildenhall, and I'm co-founder and chair of 21st Century Brand. 4 years ago, I had a set of twins, a little brown skin girl, a little white skin boy. And without question, the impact that they've had on me as a leader is to practice kindness and appreciation. It is so easy to tell my daughter or my son, you did a good job, you did really, really well, I'm proud of you. And so putting that back into the workplace has made me a more effective leader.
Hi, I'm Paul Dyer. I'm the CEO at Lippi Taylor Group. I have two daughters, 4 and 6. They are actually here with me. They're at the pool right now. They're not here. They're having a great time. It's Father's Day week, so I brought them with me. I would say the one thing that I became a lot more cognizant of was being proactive and enthusiastic and telling other people to put their family first. Because before that, I was kind of like, sure, like, do what you got to do. Like, put your family first, make your choices. And after becoming a dad, I realized you kind of need that push every now and then of somebody else telling you, no, don't come to the meeting. Do the thing that you got to do for your family first. And so I'm a lot more proactive about that now.
I'm Matthew Siegel, founder of Attention, digital media, social storytelling company. I had twins 11 months ago. So, boy, girl, and my first lesson is I no longer need an alarm clock, so I haven't had to use the timer beeper on my phone to wake me up basically in 11 months, other than here I can, where I don't have my kids. The second lesson is just being more conscientious of how many parents there are in our workplace, especially around times of day. I'm very conscientious of bath time in my house, most people have, and you know, I try not to call moms and dads from like 5 to 7 because they're probably putting their kids down. And I've never thought about that until I became a father, but now it's very much on my mind for all of my colleagues, and I think it's probably made me a more empathetic leader.
Hi, I'm Phil Duncan. I'm the Chief Design Officer for Procter & Gamble. I'm on the other end of the children's spectrum regarding age. So I have two lovely daughters that are 27 and 23. And yeah, a little woo, like I'll take that. We've accomplished a lot together. I would say there's some lovely comments made by some of the other panelists in terms of empathy and care. But I think when you have kids, you realize you need to embrace spontaneity, because I know it might be shocking, as the design officer for P&G, I might be just a little controlling and exacting and have a high sense of perfection, and kids absolutely threw that out the window. But actually in those moments of spontaneity and play, the work can actually get better. And so how you can bring that into your work, I think, is a really interesting insight.
Hi, everyone. I'm Nick Mercurio, Chief Client Officer at Ipsos. And as they shared, we're a global research opinion polling company, very proud to be the research partner with Female Quotient and to have done the work that was shared earlier. I'm based in Seattle. I have a daughter who's 5, Lena, and a son who just turned 3, Luca. And when you asked this question, my first response was, I don't think you want me to say I was more irritable after having kids. But the truth was, of course, you're sleep deprived and you have to be conscious of that. I think being a father has taught me to be an even better listener. Sometimes in those moments of frustration with your children, you realize, you know, if you really listen to understand what's going on in them, you can more empathize with them. And I think in the workplace as a leader, all too often, you know, of all genders, but particularly as a male, your first inclination is to have the answer and to speak first. And I think it's really, really important to remember to listen and make sure that you're hearing the other individual before you do that.
Great answers. And so, you know, men are notorious for not being great at expressing our emotions, and we tend not to, you know, be as vulnerable as maybe we should be as leaders. So I'm curious, we'll start on this end. How did becoming a father kind of change your views on vulnerability and expressing emotion to your employees and in the workplace, and really helping employees really understand where you were coming from as a person and how you were leading? So we'll start on that end.
Sure, happy to. So I think it's interesting. A bit of a dichotomy. In some respects, it didn't change at all. And then in other way more than I could have ever imagined. And I say that because I feel very fortunate to have been born into a family with the middle child, with two sisters, on one on each end. Born into a family of matriarchs, so just incredibly strong women, and also men, so my father, uncles, grandfathers, who did not necessarily embody that traditional view of masculinity, and so they were open and emotional and, you know, good listeners. They cried. So I think in some ways, you know, I was primed and very fortunate from a young age to have a different view of masculinity. But at the same time, I think we all know that societal forces are so powerful in this and shaping what, you know, a girl should be or a boy should be. So as a father, I'm even more conscious of that. I mean, we're here at a media and advertising conference, and each child having their own profile on streaming platforms, I'm like hyper-conscious and aware of the things that are being, you know, fed to them. You know, if my son logs in, he's getting, you know, movies about ninjas and violence and fighting, and my daughter is getting, you know, Pinkalicious and cooking videos. And so, you know, just hyper-conscious of exposing them maybe to things that society wouldn't normally put in front of them. So, you know, reading to my son, you know, books like Sophia Valdez for Prez and things like that to expose him to strong female leaders.
There you go. Okay. I would say that an element of what is maybe having children brought into my leadership style was one of demonstration of care, because I think all of us work in a people industry. And so I think I've always been a caring individual, but expressing that very openly in the workplace, and allowing through behavior to people see that not only that is my approach to building a team and making sure that the group that we have is feeling wonderful about the work and working within our teams. I think it's a really powerful construct to make sure you can, through your behavior, demonstrate that you really care. And of course, as a parent, that was something that you foster every day. And expressing that, I think, is important not only in the home, but also in the workplace.
Any of you want to jump in on that one before we go to the next question?
I want to just comment on something that Nick said, and also from the panel before, just talking about bravery. I do think that upbringing has a lot to do with it, and my family is definitely a family of matriarchs. My great-grandmother ditched my great-grandfather because he was slowing her down. And it's not a bash against him. It's just she had the bravery at that point in time, and I'm old, but she had the bravery at that point in time to go out and do that. And then my grandmother followed in her footsteps and started a real estate company. And these are just super, super powerful, strong women. And that's how I grew up. And as a result, I think I've always been sort of more emotionally available because they always were for me. But I do think that that upbringing piece has a ton to do with it. But that's all.
So for the men out there who maybe aren't taking the time to really look at traditional, you know, views on masculinity and aren't reevaluating, you know, what it means to be a leader, you know, moving forward, what's advice that you would give them of where to start to really reevaluate how you kind of view the whole workplace and society in general?
I think that, taking it back to my experience as a father, it's about redefining some of the concepts that have traditionally defined men and women. So I'll give you an example. My son is 30% heavier than my daughter. He was born 11 pounds. My daughter was born 8 pounds. And now 4 years later, the 30% heavier still kind of manifests. And when they wrestle, because they're like two little lion cubs, and when they wrestle, I'm constantly, Oliver, gentle, Oliver, gentle, Oliver, gentle. And one day, my daughter, she came to me and she said, "Daddy, I'm sad." And I said, "Why are you sad?" She said, "Oliver's stronger than me." And I was like, "Oh no, what on earth gave you that impression?" "Well, he's just strong." And I said, "Strength of character, strength of humor, strength of intelligence, strength of love. You're equal in that. So just because when he sits on you, you can't get up, that doesn't mean to say that your twin brother is stronger than you." And I'm constantly reframing some of the concepts that have created other from men and women, boys and girls, masculinity and femininity. It's not that I believe that gender-specific language is wrong. I just think that the concepts that disposition one another need to be reframed. And I would encourage any leader, and it's not just male leaders, any leader in today's workplace to be very conscious of the labels that they put on other groups that may make groups feel as if they're less important or less effective.
So I think that's a great point. And I would add to this part of the conversation that, you know, it's interesting, you can reflect on what's happening with your children and then take lessons and apply that in the workplace. We recently made the decision to put both of our girls into all girls schools. And I grew up in the Midwest in public education, and I always thought that was a terrible idea. That's not the real world. And then people explained to me through a number of different ways, not only is it every person who leads something will be a girl, every valedictorian will be a girl, it's setting the example, but also that at their age, the boys will box them out. And that was the way they would talk about it, is they would show up and the girls would want to go play with the blocks, but the boys are big and boisterous and they take up space and they knock everything over and the girls are like, you know what, forget it, I'll go over here. And they get boxed out. And so for me, that was the realization of why we were going to make that choice. But you can actually look in companies with adults and you can see the boys boxing the girls out, right? And you can, if you're, you know, so I run plenty of meetings within my own company and we'll sometimes back up against the wall and watch, right? So you let the meeting kind of unfold and actually remove yourself from it and just stand and watch. And they know you're there. But it's very natural for people to just start kind of going on with the meeting. And as that happens, you'll see the behaviors and you'll see people who speak too loud and kind of shut everybody else up. And you'll see somebody who has a good point to make and yet they can't get it in the two or three times they try. And so then they just give up on it and they're getting boxed out. And so I think then just like, stop. Do you guys realize what's happening here? Let's take a moment and give the mic to someone, the proverbial mic, there's not a real mic in our meetings. We take a moment and give the mic to so-and-so, right? Because otherwise they're getting boxed out. And I just think that that's a way of thinking about it.
I bring up a good point because, I mean, I cover agencies and there are certain agencies out there that have the reputation of being a boys' club and haven't, created equity across the leadership teams. And so what are some of the practices your companies have put in place to make sure that women and diverse talent are being raised up and nurtured and turned into leaders to make sure that, you know, the status quo, you know, is changed now and in the future?
You know, our company Attention's interesting in this light because when we founded it, I co-founded it, I was in my late 20s and most of our workforce were in our 20s. And so we had like no parents working for us. And then as we've aged, now I'm almost in my late 30s. We've had a lot of our company age as well, and a lot have become parents, and we've had to develop HR and paternity and maternity and parental leave policies that are fair and equitable and give people the opportunity to be parents, but also educate the younger staff what it means to be a parent, because 22-year-old, 23-year-old, 24-year-old individuals really, you know, especially in major cities where they're not settling down as quickly, have no idea what goes into being a parent. And I didn't know until I basically become one. I'm still figuring it out. So I think it's looking to strong examples of HR policies, hiring really good human resource experts and asking them what are the most equitable parental leave and also parental support policies to design. And we looked at some of the leading companies in that category who've won awards, who've been positively and critically acclaimed through press, and modeled our policies to the best of our ability after them.
Just a quick add, you know, I think one of the things for any leader that they could do is to look at the composition of their team and ensure that there's equal representation. And as a leader, you have the ability to shape that and make a lot of those decisions as to who sits around that leadership team or who's on the broader team. So I think one, it's just making sure that you have some of the fundamentals of representation on a team. I love the comments around, then you have the responsibility to ensure that every voice does come into those discussions, because we're all trying to solve very complex challenges, and it takes a diverse team with different types of skills to solve those challenges. So we have a lot of programs at P&G. One of them I think that I really love a lot is a sponsor work. We have, you know, almost any community that you would like to kind of self-identify and join, we have at P&G. But one of the things I think is most successful is someone outside of your line of business, we build a relationship and a connection to. So there's a safe dynamic for you to have a discussion, typically with a more senior person in the organization, to get really good guidance on career and managing, you know, the balance between personal life and professional life. So that's another program that I think many other companies probably have something similar, but I think we've been really successful with.
Yeah, and I'll just wrap this portion up by saying, you know, fortunate one to work at a company that believes in this and takes it very seriously. We have stated goals around this, and you know, we're the partner of not only Female Quotient but See Her, whose mission is to make sure that women are positively portrayed in advertising. So it's in our DNA. But even such, you know, we have to be very intentional around, you know, pay review cycles and things like that. When you know, when Shelley talks about 132 years to close the gender gap, it's insane. Our organization, our HR partners, each, you know, pay review cycle does an analysis and looks for, you know, outliers and discrepancies, and we actively are working to close. We state that publicly to our employees, and you know, it's interesting. Sometimes you get backlash from certain populations, and I think it's just important to educate them. One that, you know, one of our team members has this incredible sticker on her laptop, which is something like, you know, equal rights for everyone doesn't mean less for you. It's not a pie, you know. And so I think Moody's put out a great analysis earlier this year that said, you know, by closing the gender pay gap, both in terms of participation in the workforce but also pay, it will grow the world's economy by $7 trillion, 7%. So it's, you do it because it's good for society, it's the right thing to do, but you also do it because it's good for business, and I think people start to come around and understand that.
Yeah, and Tyson, I see the next question here. If, you know, for all men, not just fathers, you know, what advice would you give them for advocating for equality? And I mean, for me, I'm not in the sweet seat yet. So one of the things that, you know, my coworkers often tell me is just simply, let me know how much you make so that we can figure out, are we getting paid the same? And so often I'm sharing salary with everybody that I can so that we're making sure that there's not pay gaps within our little, you know, team at Adweek. So I'm curious for you all, what are the some of the things you would advise other people to do to make sure that we are closing equity gaps?
That's a great question, and I'm not going to be able to answer it the right way. But personally, what I do, and this gets back to some of the commentary before, is I think mentorship programs are ridiculously important at every level, and I do think, especially if you're going interdivisional, right, like a senior leader in a different division, so you can have an open and honest conversation, and making sure that mentorship is a two-way street. Right? It's not somebody teaching somebody else. You're learning on the other end too. And that's where I think when you start talking about any employee, right? What do you want to know about work? What do you want to know about how to advance? How can you help me understand what the conversation is going on at a different level, et cetera? And I think as corny as it may sound, I think that it's one person at a time. Right? You can't do this blanket, big, mass sea change. It has to start with individual relationships. At least that's the way that I approach it. And as a result, I think the people on teams that I've been fortunate enough to have as teammates who work either on my team for me, which I hate saying, but with me, like, they do the same thing. And so I think as soon as everybody does it in the trickle down, we're going to get to a point where there aren't any secrets in the workplace, which drives me nuts.
I'd like to say that I sit on three boards. I sit on GoFundMe's board, Peloton's board, and Fanatics board. And I sit on the compensation committees of all three of those boards. And I think that a way for you to take the personal burden out of that sharing of salary is actually escalating the question, because every single board has equity and equality in the compensation policies, and it's the right that every employee knows what the compensation policies are. And I can't think of a board today that would sign off a compensation review without looking at the population data behind the salary allocations, both from a gender perspective and from a race perspective. So when the executive leadership teams roll up the compensation reviews to each of the boards, the board asks to see the data based on gender and based on minority, and the board are extra vigilant on making sure that it's equal. So I think it's right that you might want to share, but with that comes a lot of personal energy. But rolling it up to say, I actually want to see the compensation policy for the company. I want to see how that compensation policy impacts the employees at my level. And you want to ensure that, and if the board are asking the right questions, then the implementation of fairness from a pay, bonus, and equity perspective is going to be implemented.
I was just going to say, just really quickly, I think that's part of, like, it is their right to know, whoever's right. And that, from a mentorship standpoint, ask the question. Ask your HR leader what it is, because it is out there. I totally agree.
Yeah, I was just going to add, I like that answer a lot more than we should all just share our salary numbers. Because when that happens to me, you've essentially said you've given up on leadership. Right? We don't trust leadership anymore, so we have to figure this out among ourselves. Instead of your answer was, hold leadership accountable. Right, and that to me is the answer, and that's enrolling them, and that's. But you also have to be clear and communicative, because otherwise, a lot of times we're just guessing. We're like, maybe they want a better 401k, try it. Or like, maybe they want us to pay on their student loans, try it. And then afterwards, we come back, and they're like, I never cared if you paid on my student loans. Right, so I think being more communicative about what does really matter in the full spectrum, and it's not just like all the things. It's like kind of like what would be most impactful. And then enrolling leadership and holding them accountable instead of kind of usurping that.
I know we're short on time or out of time, but I would just echo that and say transparency in decision making and taking the time to explain your decision making. When you don't take the time to explain your decision making, people will often ascribe nefarious intent, sometimes inadvertently, to your decisions. And I think it's really important to do the work of explaining your decision making on everything from salaries to promotions to how governance at large is done.
We're out of time, but I want to give the two of you a chance for a final word if you want to get in there.
Sure. I just first want to say thank you. You know, the data show that we not only need to have these conversations as, you know, all genders, but men in particular, but want to. And so appreciate the platform and all that Shelley and her team and the female quotient are doing to further this incredibly important discussion.
Yeah, my close is maybe a little less eloquent and emotional, but I was going to say accountability, tracking, and measurement. And it sounds really boring, but almost every meeting with my leadership team, we look at the numbers within each sub-team and say, how are we doing? We have a real need to represent the consumer who we serve and the people who are creating the ideas and our brands. There's no better way than just frankly setting the standard and then tracking it, measuring it, and holding people accountable to it. So,
all right, that wraps us up. I think we have one video. Is that?
Yeah, we do. Okay. So just very quickly, one of the things that we find a little inequitable or not inclusive for the men, particularly the fathers at Cannes, is they do it during Father's Day.
Right.
Which
awful,
is rough. Awful. And so anyway, we just have a little video to say Happy Father's Day to you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
My bestie and your bestie sit down by the fire. Your bestie says she want parties, so can we make these flames go higher? Talking about hey now, Aiko, ane. Chucking more fina, anane. Chucking more fina, ane. Bestie and your bestie dancing by the fire. Your bestie says you want parties, so can we make these flames go higher? Talking about hey now, hey now, hey now, I go, ane. Chucking more fina, anane. Chucking more fina, ane. Chucking more fina, ane. Chucking more fina, ane. Chucking more fina, ane.
unfolded as